As I'm sure you know, Bell is a special adventurer. He levels up much faster than everyone else, and his basic stats often go above and beyond the max S rank, going all the way to the double S and triple S ranks that not even the Loki Familia knows exist. But what does all that actually mean? I mean, leveling is one of those components that you hear mentioned a lot throughout the anime. It plays a significant role in dictating the power level of all the characters, yet we're never given any context as to how it all works. All we ever see or hear is that X character leveled up and is now significantly stronger. So let's see how these things work and then check out Bell's current stats and see exactly how strong he is compared to everyone else. But first, this video is sponsored by Last Claudia, a brand new mobile RPG from Eidos bringing us a stylized yet classic pixelated adventure experience. And seeing these pixel art characters traverse this 3D world and take part in fast-paced real-time combat actually looks pretty damn good, especially with all the flashy moves and crazy attack animations. Then there's the fully customizable character stats for any of the gacha characters that you pull into your party. And if you ever get bored of the cinematic story mode, then you can switch over to the arena and battle others online in global PvP. Not to mention that until December 13th, there's currently a collaboration event with the Nintendo JRPG series, Collection of Mana. In this event, you can see key characters and locations from the Mana series recreated in the style of Last Claudia. So if you're interested, go ahead and use the link in the description to start playing for free today. And after you finish the tutorial, you'll earn 3,000 crystals or 10 gacha rolls through the Beginner's Welcome campaign. Now, let's get back to the video. In Orario, the ability to level up, gain experience, and subsequently go stronger all stem from what's called a fauna, a central concept in the world of Danmachi that we've only ever seen a couple of times in the anime. They're displayed as the black markers implanted onto the backs of newly recruited adventurers who join a familia. Every familia member has one, and they're meant to signify the fact that they've received a blessing from their god or goddess. But simply calling it a blessing is a rather tame way of putting it. The fauna does a lot more than you would originally think for the person receiving it, reason being that it basically involves the god incorporating a portion of their divine powers, aka their arcanum, into the adventurer. This includes a bit of the essence of their being that allows them to be immortal, which is why when an adventurer gains a fauna, they begin to age more slowly, resulting in their lifespan essentially increasing. Take Finn for example. Sure, he may still look like a young boy, which is rather normal for a fully matured prum, but he's actually over 40 years old. Mind you though that this does not make the adventurers themselves immortal. It also doesn't affect puberty. The stage of life that's affected the most is adulthood. However, the actual rate at which people age is all dependent on the type of person and their level. You see, the higher level you become, the stronger you get, because you've absorbed more divine power into your being, thus growing your fauna. Hestia likes to put it this way. Every time an adventurer goes up in level, they move one step closer to godhood, and each step closer to godhood makes you age more slowly, still not quite letting you live forever, but making it significantly longer than the average lifespan. Now, whether someone could become such a high level that they practically become a demigod is a whole nother question, but I wouldn't doubt its achievability. In that same vein, the amount of power or vitality you can receive from this fauna also depends on the type of person and their level. It's no secret that it gives you a massive boost in your physical abilities, but the extent to which these abilities can grow is all different. That's where Excellia comes in. Think of this as a more advanced type of experience points, experience that works towards fueling the fauna. Just like in an RPG video game, a fauna allows adventurers to work towards upgrading their own individual stats. Normal people who have yet to receive a blessing from their god are pretty much all level 0. They have minimal stats and would be completely useless if they were to try to fight even the most basic of monsters. But once they receive that fauna, it basically automatically upgrades them to level 1, granting them what we would refer to as a status and giving them power that is significantly stronger than a normal human. This status displays 5 key trackable parameters that dictate their overall power: basic abilities, development abilities, magic, skills, and level. Excellia works towards upgrading or improving each of these, but the area in which you can see its effects the most is with the basic abilities. This is broken down to the fundamental areas of strength, defense, dexterity, agility, and magic. Within every level, each basic ability has one of 10 ranks, S being the strongest and I the weakest. Alongside these letters are a numerical score value that displays exactly how strong an individual is in that area. A score of 0 to 99 ranks you at I. 100 to 199 ranks you at H, and so on until 999, with that being the max value that a person can reach. Unless of course you're Bell, which I'll soon explain. But as an adventurer gets stronger, it also gets harder to grow their Falna, and it eventually becomes extremely difficult to further progress. Think of it like an inverse exponential curve, where going up the levels means more higher quality experiences needed to boost your stats, resulting in a slower rate of growth. But before even getting more into that, I'm sure you want to know how someone even goes about gathering that experience in the first place. Well, that brings us back to the concept of Excellia. As I recently said, it's essentially the experience system that fuels a person's growth, but the way it functions is a little bit different from what you would expect from a typical RPG. Excellia works in tandem with the Falna. Gaining Excellia can be done through a variety of means. For starters, you can get some by just exercising your basic abilities. So, say Bell wanted to improve his defense stats. All he would have to do is get hit a few times by some monsters, and that experience of taking damage will go towards increasing his defenses. The improvement would be marginal, of course, but doing so over and over again would eventually make a big difference. Then, say Bell wants to raise his agility next. He can do so by running around and dodging attacks, something that we see him do quite a lot, which is why his agility stats are so much higher than the rest. The thing about this method of upgrading your stats, though, is that the Excellia gained in the moment through whatever adventure or obstacle you've just overcome doesn't reflect immediately on your Falna. Reason being that your Falna does not upgrade your stats in real time with your experiences. In order for any Excellia to be adapted into your stats, your Falna has to be updated by your god. Only after this happens will all that Excellia be distributed towards the development of things like your basic abilities or new skills and magic. The reason it works like this is actually pretty interesting, because this is where Excellia starts to branch off from the typical experience points systems and really focus on the literal experience. You see, Excellia is something that basically tells the gods what path an individual has walked up to that point. It's literally a recount of their child's experiences. A god basically reads a person's history through their Excellia, and it's by doing this that they will know if that person slew a monster, fought an army, or simply just had a good bit of practice. Everything someone has accomplished, both quality and amount, shows up in Excellia. The gods will see their life story, see their achievements, then update the hieroglyphs of their children's Falna to match what the Excellia has shown them. In order for this process to happen, a goddess like Hestia must first drop a bit of her blood onto Bell's Falna. The blood will reveal Bell's statuses, cause them to rise up, and allow them to be modified. Hestia is the only one that can do this for Bell. No god can update, overwrite, or erase the Falna of someone that isn't part of their familia. So, to clarify, Excellia are the actual events that Bell experienced while on adventures or in combat, which go towards improving the key parameters defined by the basic abilities, development abilities, magic, skills, and levels as provided by the Falna. Now, Excellia varies based on the encounter. The quality of it depends on how difficult the task is in comparison to your level, which is why as you get stronger, it gets harder to level up. Initially, every encounter you face will be a challenging one. Therefore, you'll receive high-quality Excellia all the time and grow faster. But if you're level 4 and are still just farming monsters on the lowest level of the dungeon, then that really won't do much to improving your level 4 stats. Sure, it may have worked at level 1, but now you likely won't be making it to level 5 at all. Eyes actually runs into this problem fairly often. It's pretty difficult or damn near impossible for her to find monsters that would significantly improve her stats without having to go on a serious expedition. Bell, on the other hand, is a good example of the opposite. He's constantly putting himself against opponents that are far more powerful than he is. So the difficulty in proportion to his level is often much higher, resulting in him gaining a fairly large amount of high-quality Excellia, which in turn allows him to improve his basic abilities and level up very fast. But simply getting all your basic ability attributes to the S rank isn't enough to level you up. The act of leveling is one that involves overloading the soul with Excellia. So you just can't grind the same monsters over and over again. It's not a viable method. Even if they were slightly stronger than you, it's not something that classifies as a grand feat worthy of boosting you up an entire level. There's actually no well-defined method behind what allows someone to level up. For some reason, the light novel likes to keep it very ambiguous. All we know is that the adventurer has to have at least one basic ability at the D rank, then must complete an amazing task. It's gotta be a feat so spectacular that it will not only impress the gods, but also overlord your Falna with Excellia, pushing your stats to the upper ranks. Mind you, normal adventurers tend to plateau before that, rarely ever reaching the A or S ranks. The average adventurer will typically have stats between 500 and 800 before they level up. Many find it way too difficult to get beyond that. It's the reason why half of the total adventurers in Erario are stuck at level 1, forced to stay within their small familias. Those who actually manage to complete a spectacular feat and get to level 2 often live in larger familias, which just by being in one makes it easier to level up. But what classifies as spectacular? Well, that's subjective depending on the level. For Bell, him facing off against that Minotaur at level 1 was something amazing, even by the gods' standards. But if Eyes was to do that same thing against that same monster, well, I doubt that would even move her basic ability stats up a few digits. So, usually the best way to level up is to take on opponents that are a higher level than you. I mean, that's what Bell seems to be doing every time. But for someone that isn't Bell, attempting to take on opponents that are a higher level all by yourself will most likely result in death. Bell has special circumstances that allow him to do heroic feats like this all the time, which I'll talk more about towards the end of the video. Now, when a person finally levels up, two things will happen. First, you'll receive a significant boost to all your stats. However, there's no fixed number that can quantify exactly how much you've improved. The general consensus is, regardless of how high or low your level 1 stats were when you leveled, a level 2 will always be stronger than a level 1. That's just how much of a difference a whole level makes. But even if the stat boost was something like plus 1000 on all attributes, we won't ever actually know because of the second thing that happens. When reaching the next level, all stats will reset back to I0. Now, that doesn't mean that the level 1 stats are gone though. They're still there as a hidden baseline in addition to whatever boost was received from leveling up. Knowing this, the next question then becomes, how do we track the overall power of people who are higher than level 1? Well, let's use Bell as an example. After Bell had defeated the Minotaur, his level 1 stats were completely overloaded to the max. Like, beyond that of what was considered normal since they went past the supposed max rank of S999 and reached the double and triple S ranks which lies in the thousands. These numbers will act as the baseline for those attributes. So after updating his Fauna and reaching level 2, even though his stats now show I0, the double and triple S stats from level 1 are still technically there as hidden parameters. Now, if we look at when Bell defeated the Black Goliath, his stats all increased to the mid ranks of D to B. So what you do with these is take the numbers from the same attributes and add them to the base ones from level 1. That final summed number will be what Bell's overall stats are for that specific attribute. And just to highlight a bit better how Exelia literally works with anything, when Bell got punched a few times by Hyacinthus, his defense stat had improved from D590 to D594. It just goes to show that even getting stomped by a higher level opponent still works towards your overall improvement. I'm sure you're wondering though, didn't I just say that the max rank was S? Well, yeah, I did, cause technically it is S. So then, how does Bell have stats in double S and triple S? Well, as I've been saying, Bell is a very special exception. Most adventurers reach a point where they think they can level up, then immediately go try to overload their Exelia to complete the process. Reason being that a lot of adventurers don't want to waste their time gaining Exelia that counts for less. The grind to cap their stats at the A and S ranks is a long and strenuous one. Most would rather level up as soon as possible in order to get that quick boost and fight stronger enemies than risk fighting those same stronger enemies at a lower level for a marginal return. To them, boosting lower level stats isn't worth putting off boosting higher level stats. Even though in the long run it would be more beneficial to their overall power, the time commitment is just too much. It could take months, even years to get from that A to S rank. So why bother when you can just get an immediate power boost by only having a single D rank? Remember, the only real condition to leveling up is to have a single D rank in one of the basic attributes. The rest comes down to your personal abilities. As for Bell, he doesn't necessarily see the benefits of waiting to level up. It just kind of happens as a byproduct of his Realis Freeze ability, more formally known as Single-Minded Pursuit Realis Freeze. This was a skill developed from his experience with the Minotaur in Episode 1. After Bell was saved by Eyes, he developed a determination to become as strong as her. The skill then manifested itself after his next update, and what it does is accelerate his rate of growth so long as that feeling of determination remains the same. The effect of the skill is directly proportional to those feelings, so the more Bell feels that desire to match Eyes' strength, the faster he will grow. As we know, Bell often, if not all the time, has that flaming passion, and it only continues to grow every time he encounters a new enemy or feels dwarfed by someone else. In a practical sense, it's basically like he's using a quadruple experience buff. It provides such an increased rate of growth that it allows him to completely bypass the plateau that normal adventurers would experience when maxing out their stats towards A and S. In fact, it's so fast that it will sometimes completely blow past the supposed S limit and reach double S or triple S that not even members of the Loki familia know exist. This brings with it an interesting concept that would shake the very foundations of Arario if it came to be true. It would also explain how Bell has been able to keep up with higher leveled adventurers. What I'm talking about is that in some cases, Bell's extremely overloaded stats at the lower levels will reach a sum that is higher than the sum of other adventurer stats who are a higher level. His agility is a good example of this, because as his best attribute with a triple S rank in every level, when summing those numbers together, it will often come out to be a value higher than adventurers who are a level above him. Meaning that there are times where Bell could be level 3 and have stats that match or even beat that of a level 4. From where we are in the anime, Bell's current stats are as follows. He's only about halfway through level 3, but taking into account his previous level stats puts him much, much higher. For context, he beat Aisha with these stats while she was a newly upgraded level 4. So it's pretty safe to assume that in his current state, he can keep up with most mid to low level 4 adventurers. Anyway, that's pretty much how the stats on basic abilities and levels work. However, that's not the only aspect that we should focus on. There's still magic, skills, and development abilities that contribute to an adventurer's status. Development abilities are special abilities that have a chance of manifesting after every level. They're essentially rewards for leveling up. There could be one, none, or even multiple that appear. But in the end, you can only choose one. Bell's development ability is called Luck. Hestia likens it to a form of divine protection. Though its exact effects aren't quite known, people assume that when it's activated, it draws out some of Hestia's arcanum, which then goes towards protecting Bell. Other development abilities include Eyes as Hunter, which improves attacks against monsters she's fought before, or Welf's Blacksmith, which allows him to add special abilities to his creations. The abilities that manifest for each person are all different, and it depends on the way they control their fauna and Excelia. Certain Excelia from certain tasks lead to certain abilities. It's not just given at random. In any case, much like the basic abilities, these are also ranked from I to S, and can be improved over time with rigorous training. But since these don't reset on a level up, it takes significantly more effort and time to improve them. Skills, on the other hand, are abilities that can develop at any time, usually taking the form of passive buffs to specific offensive or defensive traits. Skills that are unique to the person are said to be rare, whereas skills that are shared between other adventurers are known to be common. The skills that do end up being developed are not only influenced by an adventurer's Excelia, but also by their personality. Looking at Bell once again, we already know he has Realis Freeze. His other skill is much more prominent in the anime. It's called the Hero's Wish Argonaut, a skill derived from his desire to become a hero. It's an attack that requires a few minutes of charging in order to be unleashed. While Bell envisions himself as the hero, white light will begin to gather around his hand, which can then be released in a massive beam of energy. We've seen it come in clutch time and time again to overcome a lot of the big bosses. In my opinion, other skills aren't so powerful, but regardless of what they may be, each seem to have a good synergy with the adventurer that they're tied to. Finally, we get to magic. This comes in two different types, innate and acquired. As the term innate suggests, this magic can be naturally used by those whose abilities and race allow it. The downside is that these races are often limited to the types of magic that they can use. However, the strength and scale of the ones that they can use are often very high. Acquired magic refers to magic-based abilities gained through a fauna. With this type, any magic can be gained regardless of race. There are almost no restrictions, and it can take on many different forms. The exact effects, though, are heavily dependent on Excelia. And magic like this requires a chant in order to be cast. The longer the chant, the stronger it is. Now, even though adventurers are capable of learning up to 3 magic spells, the occurrence of even one is rather rare. In Bell's case, it was extremely unlikely for him to learn any, as he showed little interest in attempting to do so. You see, most magic users were quite intelligent, but Bell just didn't seem like the type of person to want to sit down and study. Nevertheless, he still understood the importance of magic, since for a close quarters combat specialist like him, a ranged mage would be a very bad matchup. That's why Bell's Firebolt makes his chances of surviving a magic fight a little bit more even. Though, you may have noticed that this spell is a little bit different from the others. It's a rare breed belonging to a selection of spells known as Swift Strike Magic. Because of this, it requires no incantation. All Bell has to do to cast it is simply say Firebolt. Of course, having no incantation means that its overall power isn't anything substantial. However, it could be combined with his Argonaut skill to make it significantly stronger. So, Firebolt, his two skills, Luck, development ability, stats, and level are all described on the Fauna markings on his back. Every adventurer's Fauna displays all these parameters, but unlike Bell, who has them visibly showing at all times, most adventurers tend to have them hidden. Anyway, that's pretty much how the leveling and experience systems work. Clearly, Bell is a very special individual who has literally every aspect of his being working towards making him become the greatest adventurer. Of course, that's to be expected given the nature of the story, but with his current abilities and rate of growth, it's definitely a possibility for him to eventually surpass Eyes. There's even an interesting Reddit post that calculates and compares Bell's growth against Eyes and a few others. A few assumptions had to be made, but the overall math is pretty sound. According to the post, a level 5 Bell will start to have stats that surpass the current level 6 Eyes, so it'll be interesting to see if that actually comes true in the anime. Now, before I go, I'd like to thank Last Claudia once again for sponsoring this video. Don't forget, you can use the link in the description to download the game for free today, and get those 10 gacha rolls. Anyway, as always, thank you so much for watching, and if you enjoyed this type of anime content, then you already know what to do. So, until next time, ciao!